In this video, we're going to try to get a close-up view of the fuel and alcohol injection system used on the German V2 ballistic missile. We're going to do the demonstration employing relics that we've got in the museum here, and a bit later on we're also going to show you a hopefully an effective demonstration of the fuel nozzle used. We're going to be using water, and I'm pretty much hoping not to get too wet when we actually do that. Just to get our bearings, we're going to look at this model of the V2 rocket motor, showing the injection system at the top here, the combustion chamber and the thrust nozzle. We're going to look at this just to get our bearings and see how the parts actually fit together. And from the bottom up, some of the salient points here are the fuel inlet manifold that we've got down here. So this is where the alcohol and water mix would have been introduced into the motor, quite surprisingly, given that it's going to be actually burnt at the top here. The alcohol and water mix would actually be brought up through the dual wall of the combustion chamber, actually brought up to the head, where it will finally be introduced into the injectors and then into the combustion chamber proper, where it will be in a volatile condition with the liquid oxygen and then burnt to develop, obviously, the propelling force of the rocket. The part that we're going to be interested in are these 18 pre-stages up here, these so-called pots or burners, of which there are 18 positioned on the top part of the combustion chamber here, the injector head of the motor. Each one of these would have had an independent feed, an oxygen, liquid oxygen line coming into the center of it here on each one of these. The liquid alcohol is brought up into the combustion area and then is actually fed through the head into these pre-chambers before being burnt inside the combustion chamber. Okay, so here is a real relic from a V2 rocket. This is actually one of those 18 pre-chambers or pots that we were looking at on the model, just to identify it more fully. So this is actually the external surface of the pot. You can see it's fairly thin steel, and there is actually a cavity at the back here in this manifold. The brass parts that you can see at the bottom here are the nozzles. Now, you wouldn't normally be able to see those, obviously, from the outside. This obviously would be all part of the injector head. This would all be fully clad in. Now, what we've done with this one, we've actually cut it in two. But just before I turn it around and show you, I just want to show you the method by which the oxygen pipe would normally be fitted. I can't screw this into position. It's obviously too badly damaged for that. But this is the way that the oxygen would be supplied to the pot directly into the center. Now I'm just going to actually spin this around for you, and you can see that we've actually cut this in two, and there are the two halves. This one is very, very badly damaged, and I'm going to put that one out of our way, and we're going to concentrate our attentions on this rather cleaner and neater one here. You can see that some of the nozzles are actually missing. Now, just to again pick this off again, so now we can see into the manifold now that I've turned it around, and you can see this cavity between the main bell shape structure of the pre-chamber and the manifold here. Now, it's in this manifold that the alcohol and water mix would find its way actually to the nozzles and then into the combustion chamber. So this area would actually be dry if the pump was running and the fuel merely circulating through the combustion chamber for its cooling purpose. This area would have actually remained dry. Only when the double action alcohol valve was released would this area become flooded with pressurized alcohol and water to find its way into the combustion chamber. Anyway, let's just carry on counting the point parts off here. The main one we can see at the top here is actually the oxygen nebulizer. So let's just unscrew that from its position. This is simply screwed into place. And let me just identify some of the salient points on this for you. This is a very simple nebulizer system. We can see that it's a cast brass component, a single component. There are no internal elements to it at all. So you can pretty much see that the oxygen would come plunging down directly into this system, very much like the water in your shower head at home. Nothing particularly sophisticated about that. We can see that from the pattern of holes here, they vary in size. On the actual hex part here, and incidentally the hex part is just what you'd expect it to be. It's a nut to allow the builders to actually screw this into position with some kind of a box spanner arrangement. Then you can actually see that part has got the largest holes in it here on the hex part. They're actually about the same size as this first row of holes, but then you notice up from that the holes get progressively smaller. So they start out here at around about 2 millimeters in diameter and then work their way up to these holes that are around about the 1.25, 1.5 mil in diameter. Now there's actually about 120 holes on each one of these, allowing the liquid oxygen to come into the combustion chamber. And obviously there's 18 of these in the injector head as a whole. Here's a close-up detail showing the apertures on the hex nut element of the oxygen nozzle. Can you see at the end here as well, we've actually got the Reich Eagle and the Waffenamt number underneath it. I don't know whether you can just see that little detail there. So you've got numbers here relating probably to the year of manufacture and also something to do with the manufacturer's identification marking here. Let's just put that to one side for now. The alcohol is entering into the system through around about 68 different apertures in the system. Now they're not all the same. So although each pot had about 68 nozzle apertures in it, they do have a slightly different job, and I'm going to try to identify that for you now. The double row of swirl nozzles at the bottom here that you can see, there's one missing here, but you can see each one of these, they have a pattern of holes on them, and I'm hoping the camera can pick that up from back there. We can see that there are these four little pores around the outside, then we've got these two medium-sized holes and the large hole in the center. Now the large hole in the center is the main part, the main functional part of this nozzle. This is the swirl aperture. So most of the fuel per nozzle would be coming out of this central aperture. There's about certainly over 40 of these nozzles in each chamber. And you can see that another row of them is in position at the top here, but you notice they're slightly different. They've got the two holes on the outside for the spanner to put them in position, and a simple pour right in the center. Now those nozzles are actually used primarily for impingement onto the oxygen nozzle here, partly for cooling and to assist in the volatilization of the product that is pumped into here, but there is no, in principle, there is no serious burning done here. This is a mixing chamber. So the idea is that downrange from this system would be the mixed fuel components, being the liquid oxygen and the alcohol and water element from here. And the burning would be going on downrange in the combustion chamber proper. So some of the things that are going on here is for cooling. And in particular, this little range of apertures that we see here, you see two rows of apertures. I don't know how well that picks it up amongst the rust and the debris on this pot, but you can see these small apertures here. Here again, alcohol and water would be leaching out of here to assist in the cooling process to make sure this isn't damaged. You certainly couldn't say that any of this part is that fragile. Here's a bit of a cross section of that, and you can see it's actually quite beefy. This steel construction, although it's a bit thinner in this location where the cooling pores are, where the nozzles have been screwed into position, it really is actually quite chunky. Okay, I've got a little collection of nozzle relics to actually show you here. Now the two intermediate sized holes that you can see there are a special case, and I'm going to talk about those in just a moment. We've got the nozzle directly underneath the camera now for a close look. The central high volume hole is 6 millimeters in diameter, and it's surrounded by these four additional pores at 12.5 millimeters apart. We can also see on the front face of the nozzle this manufacturer's mark here as well. And I'm going to change the lighting so that we can see things in a bit more detail. Now, with this lighting, this top light, we can see that the two intermediate holes actually are dead ends. They are there purely to enable a wrench with two pins on it to be used to assemble the nozzle into the chamber, pre-chamber. I'm adding a probe now that's about half a mil in diameter, exploring those four smaller pores. Now, those pores are about 0.75 mil in diameter, and you can see that they open at a very simple angle directly into the central chamber. And that's the same for all four of these. Now, while I've got that there, I'm just going to flip this over and just show you the inlet pores on the rear of the nozzle. These are about 2 mil in diameter, and you can see that they open directly into the bottom of the chamber there, if I get the light just tilting that correctly. Now, if this hole went all the way through and formed a cord going from one side to the other, the middle of the cord would be coincident with the inner wall of the swirl chamber. So you can see that the hole is actually cranked quite heavily across to one side. The idea being to create a vortex and allow the alcohol to transit through the chamber and come out of the front nozzle here with a certain amount of dynamic rotation to it. The idea being to cause turmoil in the pre-chamber and assist the mixing. Let's just look at the other nozzle here as well. It's similar design, 20 mil in diameter, the two apertures there for the wrench either side of the central nozzle. Central nozzle hole about 3 millimeters in diameter, sorry, about 2 millimeters in diameter, the central hole there. And we've also got manufacturer's mark that you can see down there as well. You can also notice here the witness marks from the lathe turning method of producing this nozzle. On the back side, we can see the entry ports again with that same steeply angled penetration into the chamber to create the swirling effect through the nozzle. This one is interesting. You can probably see from the rough condition of this that it's actually made of steel, and it's identical to the top nozzle that we were looking at earlier, but obviously the Germans were actually worried about corrosion on these nozzles, and they abandoned this idea of making them in steel in favor of making them in the brass that was actually used on the production rockets. So this is prototype only, and you can see that corrosion has really taken its taken a toll of this one. As ever with these kind of things, where we're talking about the theory of how this kind of structure actually functions, it's not easy to get a kind of visceral feel for what's actually going on. So we're going to go outside now and actually look at a little demonstration we've got for you, utilizing original swirl and top nozzle inlets, and see how the spray pattern actually looks when we pump water through them. What we've done here is we've made a holder for the nozzles. So these are the nozzles we were showing you earlier, and we've connected it up to a system that gives us a chance to control the pressure of what we're going to hit this with. Now obviously we're going to use water. We've connected this to a domestic water supply main, and we're going to hit this with the same kind of volume of water and at a similar pressure than was actually used in the injection head. Now we've been quite surprised by the fact that the spray pattern doesn't seem to be that sensitive to the pressure that we're actually hitting this with. And just to give you an idea of the kind of flow we're looking for from just this one particular nozzle, typically about 47 grams of alcohol fuel would need to be coming through this per second. In our test range, we got from 39 grams to about 58, depending on the pressure. But the spray pattern looked pretty much the same, so we're reasonably sure we're on the right lines here. We're in the right ballpark for the amount of flow we're actually allowing through this nozzle. Now, the first one we're going to show you is the bigger swirl nozzle that appears in two rows at the lower part of the pre-chamber. You remember we saw the two rows of larger nozzles at the bottom, the lower part of the chamber. That's the first one we're actually going to be showing you here. Later on, we're going to show you through the upper nozzle that was impinging onto the oxygen nozzle. So first of all, let's show you this one. Let's start it very gently at first. So you could see that it begins to work at quite low pressures. And there you go. I would say that's running at pretty close maximum. And we've got a long way to go there in increasing the pressure. Hopefully that's showing you something there. It kind of looks like the GoPro is very much in the eye of the hurricane. You can see there's very little water spraying onto the lens of that. And I'm going to move that off to one side there. I don't think you're seeing very much in that position. Difficult to tell what kind of image that's going to be giving you. We've changed the nozzle over and we've now got the simple single aperture nozzle in here. This is the one that impinges directly onto the oxygen nebulizer, and you'll see it's got quite a high flow rate but is a much simpler pattern. So I'm now going to put that up to full power. Okay, there we go. And you can see the character of that. It's a very gentle nebulized and only a single aperture on this one. And introduce it into the flow there. Okay, the two nozzles we've just shown you there were actually contributing about 47 grams per second. Bear in mind there was about 45 of these brass nozzles and some other pores per pot. So you've got about 68 apertures delivering into each of the 18 pre-chambers. What we're showing you here is 10 seconds worth of just one nozzle. So this is 10 seconds worth through the original swirl nozzle that we showed you earlier. The reason I've shown you 10 seconds worth is just to bulk it up a bit so that you can actually see what 10 seconds worth of alcohol through one of those nozzles look like. So you've got a clue here to the efficiency of the motor. Bear in mind, each one of those pots was capable of delivering about 1.5 tons of thrust. That's it for this video. We'll see you again soon. Bye now.